It's wonderful for me to return to Edinburgh. I grew up here in the 40s and 50s, and I've seldom returned since then. After living in the south of England for so many years, I see lots of things that have changed in the city. But the biggest changes, without doubt, have been in myself. This building at the foot of Holyrood Road is the former brewery of William Younger. It's soon to be demolished to make way for the new Scottish Parliament. And here, almost half a century ago, while waiting for the obligatory call-up for national service, I was employed as an office boy. My desk stood as high as any Dickensian clerk, and every day I sealed over 200 envelopes using my tongue, and then appended as many tuppence halfpenny stamps, licking the back, of course. The only way to remain sane, especially for the teenager I was, full of unfulfilled ambitions and unidentified aspirations, was to take advantage of the hour and a half lunch break to escape. To escape to that remarkable extinct volcano that I could see from the window. My favorite place, that sleeping lion, Arthur's Seat. Arthur's Seat erupted around 350 million years ago. Although some 823 feet at present, it was originally much bigger, twice the height of what remains. As the elements have eroded the mountain, features originally inside the volcano have become exposed, such as Samson's ribs, formed from basalt that cooled slowly into six-sided columns. In spite of various romantic Victorian ideas about any connection with the King Arthur of legend, it seems that the name could most likely be a corruption of the Gaelic Ash na Saidh, meaning Hill of the Arrows. These days, the crags are home to the fulmars, ocean birds related to the albatross. They are famous for one of the best defensive strategies since nature invented the skunk. They spit regurgitated fish at intruders with remarkable accuracy. They are newcomers, however, and weren't in evidence the day I decided to climb straight up the highest part of the crags. I was wearing a suit, a tie, city shoes, and a flapping duffel coat. It was idiotic. But I did it. The frustration level must have been particularly high that day. What is unusual in the look of the Salisbury Crags is that many of the rocks are not the result of natural formations, but the consequence of an immense amount of quarrying for the paving of Edinburgh. Nearly 50,000 tons of rock were removed before a public protest put an end to the practice. This must be the largest area of unmanicured wildscape at the heart of any European city. It offers solitude and stimulation and something else, almost magical. Here I could be myself, what I wanted to be. Here I no longer had to suppress my emotions. On the way up, it was possible to stop here at St. Anthony's Well and quench one's thirst. The water is said to have great curative powers. I thought at the time it was doing me a great deal of good, but looking at it now, it was probably doing a great deal of damage. The well sits on the path that approaches the remains of St. Anthony's Chapel. In fact, tradition says that this 15th century building was originally founded to guard the holy well itself. In its heyday, a hermit tended the altar, and at night, a lamp burned in the tower to guide the mariners on their journeys up the Firth. Now only the north wall remains, another victim of extensive quarrying. In the pursuit of an acting career, my family on the whole were supportive, particularly my mother. My father did have initial doubts about his only son joining a band of queeries, as he quaintly put it. And even greater doubts when he heard the sounds coming out of my mouth. You see, even after mastering received pronunciation, on my visits home, I would guiltily try to fall back into Scots. But I'd lost the knack. Eventually, my mother said, "Oh, for God's sake, son, just do your normal voice." As you gain height during the ascent, all Edinburgh spreads out below you. To the west lies Calton Hill and the observatory. Further south, the castle on its rock. And below it, the old town straggling down the Royal Mile and Canongate to Holyrood. James Boswell paid his tribute to the mountain in these words. "Beloved hill, the admiration of my youth, thy noble image shall ever fill my mind. Let me travel over the whole earth, I shall still remember thee, and when I return to my native country, while I live, I will visit thee with affection and reverence." Many of those words ring true for me. And occasionally I do feel pangs of regret at leaving the city, family and friends, in the pursuit of what? Dreams, perhaps. But although no longer belonging, I'm proud of my roots. I remember on a visit much later, standing looking out of the window of a house down there by the edge of the park, and watching two small boys scrambling up the hillside just as I had done so many years before. They were my own sons. It was quite an emotional moment. Onward and upward. On reaching the summit, one has a feeling of exaltation, of rejuvenation, and a touch of nostalgia, because I used to do this climb in under 30 minutes.
What was I thinking of when I came up here in my unhappy young years? I'm not sure. It's a different person now who looks at this view. And perhaps the old one is gone forever. But I remember him most standing here.